As a premier national professional accountancy organization, we have a prime responsibility to bring all our members in addressing these challenges and working together with the government in developing the economy. It is in this context we have organized this webinar, and the registrations had to be closed within a day in view of the large responses received. We have invited two top policymakers of this country to address our membership at this occasion. Despite their very busy schedules, they have agreed to address the challenges faced by the economy and the initiatives taken to remedy them. We are very much thankful to them. I don't want to speak at length on my introduction. May I now invite Professor W.D. Lakshman to address the audience first. Professor, over to you.
Let me begin by thinking. Let me begin by thanking the Institute of Chartered Accountants for inviting me to address you on this occasion. Let me begin also by referring to a certain paradoxical kind of situation in the spread of the virus. In South Asia, for example, in contrast to countries in the Western developed world, the impact of the virus and its spread has been very negligible, in spite of the fact that in these developed countries, incomes are higher, living conditions are better, public health facilities are very much advanced. But in South Asia, there are conditions like poverty, overcrowdedness, health services are not that improved. Yet, in terms of the numbers affected, and also in terms of the numbers dead, South Asian region has been doing very well in comparison to developed Western countries. We are indeed in Sri Lanka contented particularly about our conditions and our achievements as far as the spread of the disease was contained. Lockdowns introduced in the country from early last month mitigated the virus spread, saved lives, but at the same time it took away livelihoods. Large numbers of the self-employed and also the casually employed are badly affected. The problem will not vanish after lockdowns are lifted. In the short run, it would be a matter of survival for households with minimal economic growth this year. But in the medium term, for example, next year, there would be, we hope, recovery. It will take time to regain past successes in, for example, poverty alleviation and full employment. In this brief presentation, what I will do is the following. I will present to you some general ideas which I thought would be of interest to participants or listeners. Then I will present a few thoughts about some selected sectors in the Sri Lankan economy which are going to be opened up and starting to perform after COVID-19. This will be followed up by another set of short comments on some general ideas. Let me take up a few basics to begin with. There has been social distancing and curfew for quite some time. These things cannot be kept too long. If it is kept too long, its effects on the economy and on livelihoods will be unduly disruptive. Must therefore get the people out of curfew mentality soon, anyway. But moving forward to bring back normalcy has to be done cautiously, opening little by little, being watchful about the further virus spread possibilities. Regions to be opened may have to be determined according to prospects of opening up while retaining preventive health practices. There is need also for a planned prioritization of economic activities to be opened up according to prospects offered by different activity areas for employment and income generation. This prioritization of economic activities to be taken out of curfew conditions has to be based not only on domestic factors, but also on overseas factors. Because the timing of the arrival of normal conditions will vary between us and our overseas partners in business. Let me compare the pre-COVID-19 world and post-COVID-19 world as I see them. The dominant worldview before COVID-19 was dominated by what we sometimes call the neoliberal thinking. As it evolved since the late 1970s or the early 1980s, particularly strongly so since the 1990s. We are familiar with the main elements in this worldview called neoliberalism. The markets, importance of markets were highlighted, and the dangers of state intervention has been also highlighted. Globalism was valued as against nationalism. Domestic capital was considered of a lower standing than foreign capital. There was also the dominance of finance capital over physical capital. The scenarios developing under the influence of COVID-19 would most probably change some of these pre-COVID-19 worldviews. Post-virus likelihoods in respect of policy thinking may be briefly referred. There will be problems raised about state versus private sector problems. Problems will be raised about the importance or otherwise of state-owned enterprises. The globalization and its prospects will be questioned. Foreign direct investments, international value chains, import-export processes, tourism, foreign overseas tourism, immigrant work, export-oriented industrialization as opposed to import substitution activity. There will be questions raised about this, the validity or the continuing validity of globalization. There will be doubts also about what liberalization, so strongly trusted in the recent past, can achieve in changed conditions. Although signs of change are very visible, there are still very strong elements aiming to go back to the old world. An environment surrounded by conflict would remain in respect of policy thinking and practice because of these differences of opinions. Moving forward, we have to be concerned about some of the problems of the economy of Sri Lanka. I'm citing some numbers here. Even if I don't mention the year, these are all referred to year 2019, numbers taken from the recently released central bank report. Our public debt, rupees 13,031 billion, or 86.8% of GDP, is at a quite a high level, problematic level. There are continuing budget deficits. 6.8% of GDP is the 2019 number. Interest payments are the largest component of recurrent expenditures of the government, about 39% of the government recurrent expenditure. Salaries and wages come next at 30%. And there are the external sector problems. Trade deficit, 9.5% of GDP. Current account deficit, 2.2% of deficit. 2.42%. Then important sources of foreign exchange inflows are very seriously affected. Tourism, remittances from overseas workers, immigrant workers, garments, exports. All these have been affected badly by COVID-19. The external debt remains very high, 6,402 billion rupees. Repayment problems are there. Foreign exchange reserves are not all that great, but we have 7.6 billion, which can be used to repay loans if we have to. So there is no repayment issue in the case of our foreign loans, but there is some foreign exchange pressure, which has to be carefully managed, maintaining exchange rate stability as we are doing now. In addition, there are in the country large numbers in unemployment and underemployment, particularly after this COVID-19. Poverty conditions have improved in the country, or supposed to have improved in the country in the past, but now they have started worsening. And then there is the large investment savings gap. So these three gaps in the Sri Lankan macroeconomy, the budget gap, the current account gap, and the savings gap. These are not at all creations of COVID-19, but are conditions, but the conditions regarding all three have got worsened as a result of the virus. So in the opening up phase, the government has taken agriculture first, domestic agriculture. Opening up has been guided by the need to increase employment opportunities. As people cannot be sustained through government subsidy payments for too long, rural agriculture activity has been considered easiest to open up, even under curfew conditions. Agricultural work already commenced even under curfew. Employment, incomes, survival, and food security are considerations which led to this policy action. Very high proportion of paddy land has already been harvested and some cultivated for the next season. Extensive agricultural activity covering many crops are taking place, and even including home garden. Policy innovations to meet post COVID-19 conditions begin to appear in this area. For example, the import controls and protection to domestic economic activity from imports. These are supports to agriculture which were not there in the past and are being introduced gradually in the present period. One important thing, of course, has to be mentioned, but it is maybe temporary short-term benefit. Agriculture has lost its attraction to the young labor, the youthful labor in the country. Now this young labor has come back into it, maybe temporarily because of the curfew, but some benefits of this probably would remain. Problems and policies to assist small farmers in different segments of agriculture have been implemented by the government in a number of areas. In the case of major crops and their small producers, certain farming technology related policy innovations in terms of import policy, in terms of marketing issues, finance, post-harvest technologies, value-added activities, small, large linkages or subcontracting arrangements, from domestic market to export markets, promotional activities, institutional reforms to enable small producers to achieve self-reliance and gradual growth. These have been undertaken little by little. And when we take minor crops, the prospects for replacing imports in respect of these crops is very high, And also promoting exports. Packages of required state assistance, finance, technology, in terms of production quality and all, marketing, needed purchase agreements, etc., and identification of interested companies to undertake these activities, import replacement, and gradually leading to exports. Also, modern technology, particularly storage facilities with refrigeration, these are gradually coming up for policy action being taken gradually. If we take the other large sector, manufacturing, the structure of the manufacturing sector in the country, we know there is, on the one hand, manufacturing activities for the domestic market and for exports. Then there are manufacturing activities which are divided into large-scale industries, medium-scale, small, micro-scale, and also cottage industry. Then distribution of employment in the sector has to be taken into account. The problems in the sector are usually technological, marketing, export markets, achievement, acquisition of export markets, then financial problems. A factor favoring under import restriction industry, factors favoring industry under import restriction is that there is now, unlike in the 1970s, so that early period of our attempt at import substitution industrialization, is that there is now a developed entrepreneurial class to take up these challenges and these activities. So when it comes to industrial policy, we might be moving from an import-based economy to a manufacture-based economy if policies are properly taken and private sector is responding to those policies in a proper way. To make Made in Sri Lanka a reality, and there are the required trade policy adjustments which the policymakers are making gradually. Those beginning to substitute for imports should branch out to exporting as time passes. Government pressure and stimulus for this is needed and will be provided. Fiscal and monetary stimulus is being provided. Then promotion of R&D activities, education to produce high quality labor, established export oriented industry need to produce their raw material and intermediate locally to increase local value added. Production of machinery and tools for agriculture and other widely practiced economic activities could also be parts of the activities in the industrial sector. The last main sector I wish to make a few comments is tourism. Tourism in 2019, you know most of the numbers. Sri Lanka ranked as the top best destination country by Lonely Planet. The recovery of Sri Lankan tourism after Easter Sunday terror attacks happened within between 5 to 6 months. By the end of the year, the sector was virtually resurrected. Performance of the industry in year, tourism industry in year 2019. The numbers are available. I don't want to repeat those numbers. The tourist arrivals, tourist income, number of rooms, etc., etc. Tourism before virus, there were indirect and informal sector impact of the virus, which were perhaps very serious, very much more serious than for the large sector. I'm not saying large sector was not affected, but these small sectors, indirect sectors, the effect was very large. Indirect employment around 219,000, nearly 60% of the total tourism employment has been widely affected. The impact of COVID-19 on informal tourism sector is more severe than in the formal sector. I have figures of tour guides of different types, tourist drivers, different types of guides, then safari boats, things of this sort in the informal sector. Employees working in tourism-related businesses such as spice gardens, village tours, elephant safaris, cinnamon tea, gems and moonstones, certain percentage of general taxi drivers, employees, etc., etc. Approximately nearly 350,000 persons involved in tourism and hospitality industry have been affected by COVID-19, and maybe 1 million when it comes to family members. Let me go on to my final general comments. Year 2020, I consider it would become a watershed, a turning point in the progress of our economy. As on many early occasions, I'm sure Sri Lanka will rise like a phoenix, renewed after calamity and disaster of COVID-19. Some globally significant changes associated with coronavirus could be noted. Could these become more permanent? Some of the things which I have mentioned at the beginning. How could these be used to make coronavirus a blessing in disguise? Now there is this low oil price scenario. We ought to consider what are the implications of it. How could we benefit from it? What businesses and others can do now and in a low oil price future, if it continues for some time. Government is making good use of this opportunity to improve balance sheets of Electricity Board and the Petroleum Corporation through a fuel stabilization fund. Opportunities gained by SMEs through policy-induced or unavoidable import restrictions and credit and other supports the system has provided for them. Subcontracting systems that may develop. These are some of the things which I noted as possibilities in this, after this turning point. I have been asked to refer to lessons for the professional classes. I do that as my last discussion point. We have two professional classes, I think, have to rethink. Post-COVID-19 could be very different from pre-COVID-19. Differences in suitable or required patterns of behavior or systems of management between the two periods ought to be thought about and suitable changes expedited. Professional classes have to do this. The systems used in the past may be unsuitable or inadequate for post-2020. With a likely continuation of non-availability of adequate sources of import, we might be able to successfully take up the challenges of local production, challenges which were seen as formidable in the past, now turning out to be not so formidable. Domestic production for food security. There are chances for changes in domestic consumption pattern into safer foods. For example, shift away from imported milk powder to domestically produced milk. Certain manufacturing activities formerly thought impossible can now be opening up. Professional classes how will they take up these challenges? How widespread would be their innovativeness? How would entrepreneurship as well as inventiveness develop addressing the challenges that have emerged? Some professionals in the OPA I have seen spearheading a change of mentality. With that, again, thanking the Chartered Institute for inviting me, let me conclude and give the opportunity to my friend Hartigal, Mr. Hartigal. Thank you.
Yes, and new strategies. Now, there have been large number of questions coming up. I don't know whether we will be able to answer all those questions. I will just one or two questions because of the time constraint. I will just raise one or two questions coming from our participants. One is, of course, not relevant to what you have spoken. This is about the working capital loans. I think the banks are requesting security. So what is the question on this? That is number one. Number two, these internal opportunities versus the external opportunities in the long run, how it will look? And the third question, what will happen to the exchange rate after the pandemic? And what are the steps central bank is currently undertaking in order to strengthen the GDP for 2020? I think there are many more questions, but these are very straightforward questions. I thought we can, without taking much time, we will be able to say something.
Now the first question, Mr. Karshkabhapati, has been dealt with by central bank officials in a number of public presentations in several television channels. And there are problems in this area, but I would refer the person or persons who have raised this issue to some of those public discussions, TV discussions, which appeared over the last 3 to 4 days, or even the last week. Internal opportunities versus external opportunities, which have been referred to. This is what I was trying to highlight. In more than in the past, I'm sure there will be internal opportunities coming up. For their profitability, their worthwhileness, will be highlighted during this period, as the external opportunities are going to be, even if we start now, say during this particular week or next week, the external opportunities for us will be closed, because in many foreign countries, will not be opened up for business with the rest of the world. So that is the problem with respect to external opportunities. But even now, there are certain areas in which external opportunities are being used. For example, the garment sector factories turning into producing various COVID-19 related garments, medical garments. Then about the exchange rate, as you may have seen, the central bank has been able to manage the exchange rate stability in the early part of this month. There was some depreciation of the exchange rate, but we have now stabilized it without spending too much of our external reserves. Our policy is to maintain the exchange rate stability to the best possible extent within the country's capacity. GDP to increase GDP more than is expected in 2020. This is what everybody would be trying to do. At the moment, there are varying predictions. For example, the IMF has a prediction which is very low, less than 1% growth in 2020. Then ADB has a higher prediction of 2.5%. And we in the central bank, in our annual report, we have indicated the middle level, 1.5%. These predictions are in a way subject to correction when as we move forward, when we find additional information, these forecasts will be changed. Definitely, no one doubts the fact that there will be some decline in the growth rate in this year, but we can pick it up. Our growth rate will pick up definitely in 2021, the period which I have mentioned as the medium term.
Thank you, Professor. I think there are many more questions. I don't think it is possible to ask all these questions. If time permits, I think at the end of the webinar, we will try and see whether we can look at some more questions. Thank you very much for highlighting all these. Shall we now go to Mr. S.R. Articala, Secretary to the Treasury? We will now listen to him. Mr. Articala, it's over to you now.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Can hear?
Yes, Mr. Article, you can go ahead.
Yeah. So, first of all, I would like to thank CA Sri Lanka and the public sector wing of the CA Sri Lanka, and especially Mr. Kanaka Sabhapati, for the invitation extended to be a part of this webinar. And I'm happy to be able to share my thoughts together with the Governor Central Bank. Extraordinary time due to COVID-19 pandemic. Your topic demands that I speak about the challenges for the future together with the opportunities for the future. Let me say this at the outset itself. The full economic impact of the COVID-19 is yet to be assessed. Total number of those infected is still unknown, and the final outcome is still unclear. IMF has declared the global economy to be in a slump and has shown this crisis to be unparalleled to the depression in 1930. The unprecedented action of all states to close their borders between countries and within countries, the adoption of social distancing measures have resulted in a far-reaching disruption of supply chains, displaced people, and has, in short, changed our lives beyond our wildest dreams. Sri Lanka, as you know, took early action, and the government has been able to contain the spread, and parallel to which the government took action to expand the public sector delivery mechanism to support hard-hit households, targeting the poor, the most vulnerable, MSMEs, and many other sectors of the society. While there are teething problems, you will no doubt agree that the restoration of supply chains with home delivery systems have ensured access to essential goods and services, which has been extremely useful in facilitating the lives of the people during this period of lockdowns and social distancing. Well before the advent of COVID-19, the country's growth story has been on a downward path or trajectory, with growth in 2019 at around 2.3%. This is an 18-year low, with a debt stock, as Governor mentioned, around 87%. Revenue, which was expected to reach 2,400 billion, only 1,893 billion, which is less than 2018. Although the fiscal deficit stands at 6.8%, which Governor mentioned, this is excluding the finance minister in February 2020 announced in Parliament around rupees 300 billion of both unpaid and unaccounted for bills and expenditures. Therefore, in actual fact, the fiscal balance in 2019 would have been around 9%. Demand has been subdued, and as a result, we have seen consumption reducing. Banks have recorded high non-performing loan ratios at around 4% or plus, which I understand that almost about 25% of the NPLs are due to the SMEs. It is in this background that the tax reforms announced in December 2019, it was aimed at simplifying the tax system and increase disposable incomes of the taxpayers, thereby stimulating growth. As such, VAT rates were reduced from 15% to 8%. VAT threshold has been increased rupees 25 million per month from rupees 1 million per month. VAT, withholding taxes, PAYE has also been abolished. Growth forecast for 2020 was around 4%, with a fiscal deficit of around 7.5%, which includes these unaccounted unpaid expenditures of about 2.1% of GDP. It was estimated that with the tax cuts, there could be an initial decrease in government revenues, incomes picking up especially from the second half of 2020. To support this, government undertook a significant rationalizing of its expenditures. I must say, it is the first time in my career that after an election, no new vehicles have been purchased. While many had expected this to create issues, I was encouraged by the support extended by elected officials in this regard. No new office space has been rented or hired. We have managed within the existing resources. Also, I have issued circular to all spending agencies that they must identify expenditure rationalizing methods, that it will be monitored by the Department of Management Audit of the Treasury. Thus, we will ensure that the expenditure rationalization is undertaken in a rational manner. However, now the impact of COVID-19 needs to be factored in. The GDP is expected to contract to about 1.5% in 2020. This growth will be driven largely by local agriculture and import replacement businesses and industries. A gradual rebound is projected for 2021, with economic activities resuming in a new world order. While I don't wish to be pessimistic, I will first address the downside risk we will be facing. IMF has projected world output to contract to -3% from an expected of a positive 2.9% in 2020. In this too, what is a matter of concern is that our key export destinations of the US and EU is expected to record negative growth of -0.9% and 7.5%. Affecting our exports of textiles, tea and other products, and also tourism. With global oil prices clinging to all-time lows, the remittances could also be
Mr. Kanagi Sabapati, I think Mr. Artigal is having a connection issue.
Any possibility of connecting? What do we do on this?
We will get his connection back online. Maybe we can go for a question or two until we set that up.
Okay. Shall we go to Professor? Professor, can I ask you one or two questions until Artigal gets his connections? Professor, yeah. I think there are a number of questions. Now, oil price is decreasing over the last few weeks. Since there is no big issue in foreign reserves, as Ms. Lakshman said, would Sri Lanka capitalize on the opportunity for this and target in increasing the oil reserves as USA does? Professor, can you hear me?
Okay. Do you hear me now?
Yeah. Why not? Yes.
Okay. That was an interesting discussion I listened to last night in the TV. There was Mr. I think Velgapitiya talking about this subject and the importance of building up oil reserve using the Trincomalee oil tanks. Maybe the private sector is thinking on those lines, and not being in that particular department of the government, I would not be able to make any firm opinions, present any firm opinions about what the government is planning to do. I do not want to take a risk of making wrong statements. The thing which I am familiar with is this development of the fuel stabilization fund, which has helped a great deal in.
Sorry about that. Some technical issue from my side.
Okay.
Can you all hear me?
Okay.
Hello.
Yeah.
Yes, Mr. Artigal, you are okay.
Can we hear Mr. Artigal? Have you got your connection, Mr. Artigal? Can we hear from Mr. Artigal? Niroshi, any development on the connection?
Mr. Artigal is online now.
Yeah. Can we continue with him? Mr. Artigal, can you hear us? Shall we continue from where you left? Mr. Artigal, can you hear us? Rosie, still problem on connection, is it?
Yeah, I'm trying to get hold of him again. There is a connectivity issue, I think, with his line. So we might continue with the questions.
Professor, shall we continue with these questions? Some more questions are there. I don't want to ask all the...
Let someone else speak. Why not? There is the chairman of the organization, president of the organization going to speak, right?
Yeah, I think Manilya, I think I will be making concluding remarks, and also he will address the membership about how they can join the government in developing the economy. I think he will. Manil, are you here?
Yes, Mr. Karnataka.
Can you come on board?
I think, first of all, I must thank Professor Lakshman for sort of giving us an overview and then some of the strategies that have been there. I think he mentioned several areas where I think our membership and the profession can basically assist in taking our country back to where it was, probably getting out of this whole equation. So as Professor mentioned, there are many areas, new areas that will come. One of the strategies is, say, in the agriculture sector, for example. We want to develop that sector. Maybe, as Professor said, the good thing is some of our youth are now seeing that as a little bit more attractive than what it was in the past. So that is a sector that clearly has to be developed in our country. So in that, as finance professionals, we can help them in deciding on, say, for example, the investments that are required, the management of these investments, how you manage your finances, capital. So there's a lot of areas that we can help. Another area that clearly needs some degree of nurturing is our SME sector. This whole crisis has been very harsh.
Bad day, isn't it?
Any problem?
Now can you all hear me? Mr. Kanaka Sabhapati?
Yes.
We can hear you, sir.
Yeah. So can I continue?
Yeah, please, sir.
Yeah, because when this technical thing came, I was talking about the downside risk that the country would be facing and what especially our export markets, the growth scenario that I was talking. So continuing from there, on the fiscal side, I'm talking about the downside risks that we could face. On the fiscal side, for overall fiscal balance that we are projecting now is around 8.4%. That is including the clearance of 2019 arrears of about 2.1%. Also, we expect the impact of loss of revenues and increase in expenditures of COVID-19 impact would be around 1.5% of GDP. And this includes the 5,000 payment made to the vulnerable sections of the society, including the elderly, CKDU patients, and the people unemployed due to the COVID outbreak. And also, between May and December 2020, that is coming eight months, the foreign loan debt servicing with repayments amounts to US$3.2 billion. And this includes that US$1 billion ISP that is due to. Can you hear me?
We can hear you, sir.
All right, okay. That is due to mature in October this year. Now turning to the upside in terms of the fiscal, I am also comfortable to the extent that the impact on the fiscal side has been cushioned from undue shocks, bearing in mind, ladies and gentlemen, the impact of the tax-led stimulus package is already factored into our projections undertaken in early 2020. And the credit stimulus package that the government has announced has little upfront impact on the fiscal, given that it is more monetary and bank driven. In fact, what is happening now is, on one hand, there is a reallocation of expenditures, given that there are savings from the slowdown in capital expenditures and overheads, etc., due to the lockdown and the work from home procedures adopted. That is why, in spite of the government decision to effect a cash transfer of 5,000 to the vulnerables, which has covered almost 4 million families, and the decision to purchase agriculture produce ensuring distribution, the extensive healthcare services provided that the government expenditures have not significantly shot up. At the same time, in terms of financing the foreign currency requirement in the pre-COVID time, we were planning on raising such funds via market-based instruments, including ISBs and syndicate loans. However, that scenario has now changed. The financing part, that is, I'm talking about the external financing, US dollars, around 700 million of low-cost syndicate loan from China Development Bank, and some program loans from ADB, World Bank, AFD, and also AAIB, to the tune of around US dollars 1 billion. As many of you will know, these funding will come around 1.25% to LIBOR plus 1.25% with extended tenures. In addition, we will also access the IMF RFI to the tune of around US dollars 800 million. We are also in the process of looking into other avenues to meet our foreign financing needs. In effect, it would appear that in the post-COVID-19 times, we have been able to substitute high-cost financing with low-cost financing, which is to our advantage. I am also confident that the government decision to restrict certain imports, which has resulted in many of those imports, such as most of the medicines, being produced locally, and an increase in selected demand for food, surgical masks, protective gear, etc., will create a space around US dollars 10 to 12 billion during the second half of 2020 and most part of 2021. And also our public investment part will be different. In fact, we are working on a strategy of investment as opposed to debt financing. During this time, we have also seen business processes being streamlined. The Colombo tea auction, as you all know, being conducted online, is one such example among many more, which also includes e-procurement being rolled out. I find it also somewhat amusing, and also I am exasperated as to why these solutions, which has been talked of by many over the last few years, and is not rocket science in nature, I think you agree, could only see the light of day due to COVID-19. That is why the government is keen to ensure that the many innovations ranging from masks to ventilators to robots to ICU beds that we see in the media needs to be supported to augment to commercial production, provided they meet the necessary quality standards. These are opportunities we have to seize. We might actually be able to diversify our exports, given that we see demand for local products ranging from agriculture produce to herbal medicines to processed food from a number of countries apart from our traditional export destinations. That is why His Excellency the President has appointed a presidential task force on economic revival and poverty alleviation to look into cashing in on the opportunity. This includes augmenting agriculture into a technology-driven modern commercial agriculture. To this end, the government support will also include releasing land for cultivation, supporting the infusion of technology, crop insurance, guaranteed prices, and know-how, etc. The disruptions we see today has had a significant impact on our children. The Presidential Task Force on Education will concentrate on widening education facilities for all children, particularly those from rural areas with no access to online learning, etc. To support the country's infrastructure, a few flagship development projects will be implemented. These include the completion of the Central Expressway by 2023-24, expanding the low-cost electricity generation capacity by almost 1,000 megawatts with LNG and coal sources, while also ensuring the use of renewable energy sources. We wish to restrain our borrowings with far more stringent due diligence, better project planning, and concern for variables such as maturity, currency mismatches, etc. I think many, both in private and public sector, has remarked that work has been ongoing in spite of the disruptions where many institutions have been operating on a skeleton staff. What does that really mean? Does it mean that we have more staff than required? Or are we undertaking activity that is not required? I think the analysis could yield many answers that are interesting and colorful. I think it's time to relook at our processes to improve service delivery and also create more opportunities. The infusion of IT needs to be seriously looked at. We have to now think of work from home to be a normal course of business, even in public sector. And that could mean a change in our regulations and even our laws. This will also mean the way we allocate resources will have to be relooked at. Let me say this. The fact that the government has been able to manage the spread of COVID-19 is commendable, not only because the government acted swiftly and had clear direction in their actions, but because of actions have been taken against an extremely constrained resource envelope compared to many other countries. Clearly, we have shown that we have the capacity to utilize our resources well. I think it's time we extend same capacity to other areas of work as well. It is where the professionals such as you come in. This reminds me of a quote by Charles Darwin, where he states that it is not the strongest
Do we have some more time? Hiroshi?
I think we have spent time on the presentation, sir. Maybe we can take a question or two. I think that's all the time we have.
I think, shall we, because of the time limitation, shall we ask Mr. Manil Jayasinghe to have a concluding remarks and also address the membership about how they can be of some, assistance to the government in the developing economy. I think, thank you, Mr. Artikala. Now, you have highlighted the current issues and also some of the strategies the government is planning. Now, I think because of the time constraints, I will not ask any question from you. I think Mr. Manil Jayasinghe will be the president of the institute, will be addressing the membership and making a concluding remarks. Thank you, Manil.
Thank you, Mr. Karnataka. And once again, I must thank Professor Lakshman as well as Mr. Artikala for enlightening our membership. But I think what stuck in my mind is one thing that Mr. Artikala said. You know, sometimes necessity is the mother of invention. I think some of these things we have probably been developing but never really took off till today. We've been talking about IT, we've been talking about innovations in IT, but nothing was put into practice as much as what we are doing today. So, one of the things I believe from this whole thing, you know, it's not all a gloom and doom scenario. all these situation has also opened out new avenues. And I think it's a matter of how we as professionals can take look at these new avenues and take them forward. We can contribute in a big way to all this. We can contribute, as I told you, in financial management. Clearly, all these new areas will require investments. The analysis of how these investments should be made, where these investments should be made, obviously falls within our expertise areas. So we can definitely help the country and developing the country. Then obviously these new things will also pose certain risks that is going to be that we are going to be exposed. Once again, management of this we can do. There'll be whole new areas of how products should be costed. These are going to be new areas. So these are all areas I think as accountants or professional accountants we can help. I think this article also mentioned about streamlining business processes. Now this is very critical. Today we can see, I think sometime back John Keel made a statement that they had only about 100 customers doing online purchasing. Today they have thousands of customers doing online purchasing. So clearly the Sri Lankan market also has now got accustomed to different styles of distribution and procuring. So these are new areas that will open out in the market. So clearly the use of IT, the use of these new technologies, use of new complete ways of doing business is going to be, I think, the order of the day. And we have to look at these things positively, look at the opportunities that is being created, and our members and our profession should basically look at this and help the economy and the society to pick this up and move forward. So again, let me just wind up, and I don't want to spend a lot of time on this. Let me just wind up by again thanking Professor for his presentation, which actually opened, I'm sure, opened a lot of our eyes in some of our members. Ms. Articula, to assure the membership and I think the economy, to say that don't always look at the bad news. These things are, to some extent, being managed and under control. So look at the positive sides of these things, and we need to now come out of this and start to slowly get back to our normalcy. Right? Finally, let me also thank Mr. Kanaka Sabhapati for organizing this session and for bringing in these two illustrious speakers who basically enlightened all of us, I'm sure, as a membership. And I'm sure our membership also will reach out to the government as to where they can assist the government in taking our economy and our country out of this whole unfortunate situation and taking it back to where it was. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Manil. Thank you, Professor. Thank you, the article and Hiroshi and your staff. I think well done. There were some technical problems. This always happened. But anyway, thank you so much for organizing this webinar at short notice and